the race. You know, when you watch the Kentucky Derby or all the races, they get in a gate, they call it G-A-I-T, and they get a speed. But when it gets close to the end, the pressure's on, and they start pushing, and they start pushing. And that's where we are, and that's what the pressure is. It's just that in time, we're going out of here, people. It's the cloud sitting down. We're feeling the lowering of the cloud, maybe, and feeling that on us. But Jesus always gave us examples of what to do and when to do. We read in John 5:19, he said, I can only do what I've seen my Father do. And Jesus always, when he made a statement, it was a great teaching. And he was teaching us there, I do what God does. Now you do what I do. You do what I did. We follow the Godhead, the authority, the pattern of the Godhead is established. And he said the husband is the head of the house and Christ is the head of the church. And I preach that. And I live by that. And I have to drink water. I'm a cancer survivor. I've had radical throat surgery, so don't get upset if I gulp up here. Just turn it up back a while. I'm going to chugging it down. But I'm thankful I'm here. It's been since 1990, and the Lord touched me right on the operating table, Pastor. My dad was an old prophet back in the mountains and had a large mass right here. And it was even on my vocal cords. It had spread. And the last thing I heard before I woke up was the doctor. He was a family friend and knew us well. And he was telling the anesthetist, he said, he held up my scan and he said, right here's a big cancer. We're going to take it out. He said, probably have to get the voice box. Just tell him all about it. That's the last thing I heard. But my dad that morning came and picked me up. He didn't want me to. He wanted me to ride with him because he was going to cover me in prayer. But you know what he said? He said, I went to the church this morning about 4 o'clock. And he said, the Holy Ghost came down in that place and said, God said, I'm going to take her through. Because they didn't even know if I'd lived through the surgery. I tell you, a word from heaven is more valuable than anything. That's why I adhere to the Word of God. And I obey and I line up. There is an alignment. We had prayer meeting here this morning and the Holy Ghost began teaching us about the alignment. There is an alignment in the kingdom of God. You will never prosper if you're a member of this church and you're trying to usurp your pastors and go over their head. You will not prosper. I'm going to tell you, you will be brought down to naught, as Scripture says. There is a holy alignment. And Jesus was teaching us this here. He said, I can only do what I've seen my Father do. He was like, I am not going out of the parameters of the Holy Ghost. And that's a lesson for us. Let's don't go out the boundaries. The Holy Ghost really moved here this morning, taught us about the boundaries and the parameters. That's a valuable lesson to know. How far you can go. I'll tell you how far you can go is how far this pastor goes. The Lord says that there are boundaries and parameters out about this place of influence, even of a name, that people will know their names above Bethel. You know, they will know. Your church is known as over Sister Ruby's, and that's a good thing because that's a good name. So we're going to stay with the Scripture. I can only do what I have seen my Father do. We should only do. And we're going to talk tonight about the last week of Jesus' life. Now here was this man who knew he had a week to live. And I think that he went into great detail in these chapters because he wanted us to know when we get down and maybe on the hourglass of time, we might be in the last week. Of course, a day is as 1,000 years. The Bible says we don't know the day or hour when he's coming. But I think we are down in the last days. And I think Jesus gave us these examples so that we would know what to do in the last days. One of them, he said, was watch and pray. Watch and pray. In the hour you think not, the Son of Man comes. That means stay ready. That means keep oil in your lamp and keep it burning, as he told in the parable of the virgins. That means to be on fire preaching the last week of Jesus, and he knew what he was facing. Yes. He already knew, because God knows the ending from the beginning, and there is no time in his knowing. So he knew what was happening. And so he had to go to Jerusalem. This was the week of Passover. And in the week of Passover, everybody has to go to Jerusalem. They still do it today. And offer a lamb. And that's what they do for atonement, for sin, for forgiveness of sin for another year. The Jews who don't believe that Jesus have come still do this to this day. It's a great time to be over in Israel. It's just an active time with people everywhere. And that's how it was in that day. And because of everybody coming to Jerusalem, Jesus didn't have a place to stay. So that week he walked back and forth from Jerusalem over to Bethany, where Lazarus and Martha and Mary lived. He was staying at their house. And he would walk back and forth. And you know, Bethany is the Hebraic name for that is House of Misery. And I thought, how fitting that this man knew that he was getting ready to go to the cross. He knew that he was going to have that journey that day up Calvary's Hill. And he knew how he was going to be beaten and how he was going to be flogged. And how he was going to be pierced in the side. And how he would wear a crown of thorns. He knew all that. And yet we see him teaching the disciples and teaching the people around him, knowing all this, all this pressure on him. That's a great example. No matter how hard things are in your life, you still need to be a light to the world around you. You still need to be about the Father's business, even if your world is falling apart. You still have to put the kingdom of God first and keep pressing and keep walking and keep going. So we see Jesus walking back and forth to Bethany. Now, isn't it ironic that when the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is born, there was no place for him in the inn. He was born in a stable. When it comes for time for him to die, Jerusalem is so full, he's walking out to Bethany to stay with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. What's that telling us? There was no place for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And that's how our world still wants it today. They want no place in the school for our King. They want no place in the government. They don't want the Ten Commandments anywhere on public or federal property, government property. It hasn't changed in all these years. There was no place for him to be born. There was no place to stay in his death. And there's no place in the heart of mankind overall in this world today. It's a fading trend. Christianity is, we are no longer the majority. We are a minority factor in the world of religion. Christianity is no longer number one. It's because this King of Kings and Lord of Lords still has no place in the heart of men. Oh God. Should be a sign to us that the world has no place for us. The Bible says the world loves her own. Loves her own. And don't be surprised when we're hated for the gospel. And don't be surprised when we see right here in the United States people being persecuted for the gospel. I think it's coming. I think it's closer than we even realize. But we see this man knowing all this. You know, my feelings would be hurt, Pastor. If every time it was a special occasion, there was no place for me. Now, come on, all of us would be like, ain't nobody got room for me. But you know what? This Jesus of Nazareth kept his head up. He kept pressing toward the cross. And he just kept spreading how to do what the Father would do. And we see him as he was walking up the road to Jericho. And it is up the road. The old Jericho road goes just like this to the top of the mountain. Jerusalem is up high. It's the highest point. And you start down here at Jericho. And if you've sung on the Jericho road, it's a Jericho road. So here was Jesus walking that road. And this is where he healed blind Bartimaeus. Now here's a man about to die. Here's a man with everything going wrong, but he's still reaching out with a helping hand and lifting up blind Bartimaeus. That's telling us no matter how hard your life is, no matter how many things are coming against you, you this last week. And see, the fig trees bear fruit twice there. They have an early crop, and it's a smaller crop, and it falls off quickly. And this was the season. This was the spring. Passover's in the spring. So it was the smaller crop. But he came by, and he saw the leaves. And see, the leaves come out first because figs are very delicate. So the leaves come out, and they make shade for those figs to where the sun won't cook them. And it keeps them soft. So when he saw the tree with leaves on it, he knew there should be fruit under there, because the leaves normally don't come out if the fruit's not coming out. It's all a package deal, kind of. And so when he saw the leaves, he expected fruit. Well, there was no fruit under there. And so he cursed the tree. But what he's teaching his disciples here is a hypocritical look. It looks this way, but when you go to fruit, get fruit, there is no fruit. If we are not a fruit-bearing tree, we've got all the signs and all the fluff, like we're doing all this and all that, but there's no fruit there, I'm going to tell you, we are, as the Bible says, a dead letter. And we are hypocritical in the sight of God. That's what Jesus said. You pull up the leaf, boys, and there's no fruit in here, we're going to curse this thing. It ain't going to bear. That's what he's teaching us. Be fruitful and multiply. Be fruitful in this last day and spread the gospel and multiply yourself. Win everybody that you can. Time is short. Let's reach out to everyone. That's what he was doing. He was teaching us, don't go by what everything looks like. Pick up that leaf and look under there. Examine things. Make sure things are what they look like, because I'm going to tell you, we live in a day and an age of deception, and Bruce Jenner proves that. Anybody that doesn't speak English and just pick up a magazine and see him now would not know that he was the one who won those gold medals as a man years ago. And I read an article that said he was standing there in women's underclothes when he received all those gold medals back at the Olympics. And he said, I had on a men's suit, but I had on women's underclothes. And I thought, Pastor, I just wanted to smack him, because I've been to foreign countries where women don't have undergarments. And he was telling what expensive ones they were. More than we would pay for an outfit. And I thought, my God, how could a man love himself so much that he would let women do without things that they need, and he would stand there in them? I'm telling you, there's a hypocritical age in this day and time. You can't look and just say there's fruit there. You better be checking it out as Jesus did. He was training us. Everything's not how the eye perceives it and thinks it is. I'm telling you, in a day of deception, you better watch everything that you read, everything that you see, because there is a great blindness upon the land today. There's a great deception that the enemy has set to trap our generations. So Jesus was saying, be careful. Be careful. Check things out. And don't be deceived by beautiful leaves and by beautiful things if there's no fruit there. We read where Jesus clears the temple. See, the money changers were cheating people who had to come in and change their currency. When we go into a foreign country, the first thing we have to do there at the airport is switch our money over. We have to give them some money, and they give us their currency back. Well, they were in the outer courts of the temple because it was atonement. See, most of them buy their lambs after they get to Jerusalem because it's just too hard of a trip to bring a lamb. And the shepherds told us that even back then, most people bought their lambs in Jerusalem, and that's where the money changers were. They were there putting up the money for their lambs. And Jesus knew that they were cheating these shepherds. They were cheating the shepherds and the people who came to buy the lambs. They were keeping more money. And he was so angry. But I want to tell you, when a preacher gets on the internet and says, I need $65 million for a new jet, that is thing. That's the same thing as the money changers cheating the people in the outer court of the temple. That man already had a jet, a good one. I looked it up. He already had one that women just die to have. You know, my husband is a man of the word. We have brought a Hebrew professors into our home for 4 years now, every other month, and they studied all 12 hours on Saturday, 12 hours on Sunday, and part of the time, half the day on Monday, just drilling my husband, just drilling. Now, he's a physician, and he's been to college 11 years beyond high school, but he still has spent 4 years getting his PhD. This man knows the gospel, and I thought he can't travel and preach much because he's just too tired. He works 55 hours as a physician. He does 12 hours of television, and he has to study four sermons. He has to do a lot of, we never go anywhere that we don't have just multiple medical cases to handle, even when we're gone. I thought, my Lord, how we would love to have that man's own jet till he can fly and preach on Sundays and come home. Be not deceived in this last days when they, I heard another preacher say that he needed, he had a real nice jet, but he needed an upgrade of $40 million because there was one airport in Alaska he couldn't land in because of the sound wall there. His jet made a little bit too much noise, and the media asked him, couldn't you drive one time from the airport, from another airport to your destiny? He said, oh no, I'm too much of a star. There's too many people seeking after me. I would have to go through too many people. I can't do that. I'm telling you, be not deceived in the last days when they just want your money. This thing is not about money. God makes a way for his church and his people. My dad pastored a church back in the mountains. We live in the Appalachian Mountains. You can tell by my accent. I'm a hillbilly. And our only resource there is coal. And coal bottoms out every so many years. And then the miners had to strike for some better benefits and pay. And so one time there hadn't been any coal run in those mountains for months, Pastor. And my dad had made sure that all families had eaten everywhere as far as his boundaries would reach. He had made sure that people hadn't lost their homes, that people hadn't lost their automobiles. I mean, our church had just gone to bat to feed the widows and feed the children and keep everybody's lights on. We had spent and spent and spent. And this was in the early 60s. And I remember one day, my dad went to pray. You heard me tell how I always sneaked and went to pray with him. But you know, I know now that that was God ordained. God wanted me to hear and see what happened in his life. Because just like Jesus said, I only do what my father did. Now I can do what daddy did. I saw it. I know it works. I was there when it happened, as the old song says. And I guess I ought to know. Woo! I saw it and I heard it. But we were at the church, and daddy went in to pray, and I think it was about 1963. And he said, God, it was Saturday afternoon, about 2 o'clock. He said, I've got all this church insurance coming due Monday morning at 8 o'clock. And he said, it's $500. Now, that doesn't sound like much, but in 1963, that's probably like $50,000 or $500,000, the way inflation has changed money. He said, I need $500 by Monday morning at 8 o'clock when that office opens. And he was just at the altar just worshiping. All of a sudden, the side door of the church opened, and the sheriff's daughter walked in. And she had five $100 bills like you would hold a hand of cards, just kind of folded out. And she said, Reverend Sturgill, Daddy just felt like you had need of this. Now, this was a sinner man. Sinner man. She said, Daddy just felt like you had need of this money. See, Isaiah said, I will answer before you call. I will answer. That sheriff lived about 40 minutes away. And the daddy had just prayed that. God had answered and laid it on that man's heart. He was riding up that mountain as we were there praying. He was already en route. And I'm telling you, that man helped a lot of families. And I heard when he was in his 80s that he was in the hospital sick unto death. And I went in, my husband and I said, I came to visit you today. he didn't hoard it up. He fed the multitudes. I said, Mr. Mullins, I don't want you to die lost because you've helped too many people. I'm here today to pray the prayer of salvation. That whole family, tears began to roll down his face. And he had cancer. He couldn't speak. But he was lifting his hands and nodding his face like this. When that man passed, they called in the governor to preach his funeral. Beware of their long robes and their salutations. You look that up, it's greeting each other with big titles. I went to a church one time. Every door had a big dollar on it. And I commented on it to the person that was taking me around the building. And all the only response they had, they wanted to tell me how much those big gold plates cost. I'm not for waste of the kingdom. I believe in stewardship of God's money.
Amen.
I'm a big one on that. And when I went around that, and there was office after office, everybody there had a position and had a title and had a big gold plate on their door. They had an office. And I thought, what a waste. What a waste. See, I don't get into that. But that Jesus said, beware of people greeting each other with big titles.
Amen.
I don't have to have a title.
That's right.
In fact, everybody just calls me Dr. Renfro's wife, mostly. See, I'm not Noah's wife. I didn't get a name. You know, she didn't get a name. That woman went through everything. Dr. Renfro set up a sawmill in our backyard for all those years. I'd burn his sawmill down and probably have him shot. You know, it took, 120 years to build that boat. Now, you think, women, he had to build that thing long as a football field. They had a lumber yard. They had a mill, a sawmill in their yard. Now, that brings in snakes in them logs. That brings in termites. That brings everything out in your yard. About 5 years into it, that would have been a bonfire to Renfro Manor. I can just tell you. That would have went up smoke. But I relate to Noah's wife because I'm Dr. Renfro's wife. I know how she felt. But that's all right because I'm not into titles anyway. It's a good thing. But he said, beware. Beware of those people. And we got to beware when everybody wants a big title and everybody wants to be seen. And everybody, but the main thing he talked about was their pride. It was a matter of pride. And I'm going to tell you, the spirit of pride in the churches across the land is grieving me today.
Amen.
And I was telling the sisters about a church that I know that they have awesome singing. I mean, it is as professional as any concert you could ever go to. But everybody on the front line, they got a big row, it's a big church, and they line up across. But everybody has to be young. Everybody has to be very trim. Everybody has to have that certain look. You have to have this wonderful hair. You have to have this stylish. You have to wear heels. It's a requirement if you're a female. You have to wear high heels. Pastor, this is what Jesus was telling them right here. Beware. 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 God is not in that. We were at a camp meeting one time. Platform was full. I'd say there was probably 400 or 500 pastors on the platform. And all of them had on nice suits, finely dressed. And there was one man there that just had on bib overalls. Well, you could tell they went all around him. They went behind him. They went behind. They went on either side and just kind of left him sitting there. And I knew it's because he had on overalls. I knew that. But you know what? Right at the very end, when all them others had done giving their dissertation, well, and that's what most of them had. It sounded like their PhD speech that they had to turn in. That's what it sounded like when they got up to preach, Pastor. But when they let that little man up, I'm telling you, heaven came down. And the Holy Ghost power moved all over that house. People began to weep and just fall out on their face. My daddy said, we got in the car. He said, I'll tell you what. There was a man that had on, this is back in the 70s or 60s when those leisure suits, those green polyester. And daddy said, I'm going to tell you right now, it ain't in green suits and green shoes. I said, no, it's not daddy. It's in knowing Jesus. It's doing what we've seen Jesus do that he saw his Father do. I want to be about the Father's business, winning the lost. I want to be about the Father's business, taking care of the widows and the children. Church today, you're doing above and beyond your part, Pastor, but I'm going to they did, they had these, they kind of looked like an S shape. They're big brass things in Israel. And they bring their money and they throw it in there. Well, the ones who want to be seen, I mean, they throw it hard. You just about have to hold your ears because it clangs all the way down that brass thing. But here came the little widow woman. The Bible says was less than a farthing. That means less than a penny was her money. And it was so small that it didn't make a sound as it went down. But Jesus is sitting there, the Bible says, watching the treasury, near the treasury. And he called his men over and he said, this woman gave all. This woman gave all. When you give out of most people's tithe sacrificially, I mean, especially young couples getting started, it's hard to write out 10%. But I'm gonna tell you, I guarantee you, you do that and you will never run out of money. I've never seen the righteous forsaken. If he has to send a sinner man to do it, he will do it. You know, we have a drug clinic of 100 addicts. And my husband, one weekend, he said, I want to do more than just be a medical doctor to these young people. He said, I want to do more. He said, I want to take them to church. I want to take them out to eat. I want to take their families. He's got 100. He said, but they'll have to have some clothes. He said, sometimes those little girls come in there and they have sold their last piece of clothes almost. He said, I have to get the nurses to put one of the scrub things around them. He said, they're just not even decent to walk in and out the lobby. He said, we have to cover them up because they done sold their blue jeans for one more hit because they have an addiction. And he said, I want to buy them clothes. I want to buy their children clothes. I want to meet them at the gas station and fill their, get them enough. You can't fill up their tanks. They'll siphon it out and sell it. You can only give them enough to go to church. But he said, I want to meet them. I want to give them clothes. I want to take them out. He said, I want to reserve a banquet room. I want to take them out for a big dinner and let them know how it feels to have a sense of family. He said, most of these kids have no family, no structure to fall back on. And I said, okay. And he said, but you know that's going to cost a lot of money. I said, it will come in. It will manifest. Pastor, we weren't even finished with that conversation that my phone dinged. I had a text. It was the grandson of that sheriff, and he's not saved either. He said, Sid, he owns a big corporation. He said, I was riding home from work tonight, and he said, you all just came on my mind that I need to send you some money. He said, do you have a need? I said, I do. I'm going to tell you about it. He said, consider the check in the mail. I'm telling you. Church, if you'll compromise and quit preaching so hard. He said, now they do things that you preach against. And it's simple things, Pastor. And he said, they told him, if you'll quit preaching on that, we got some people we'll bring. He said, God will provide. I don't have to have bribe money. I don't have to have compromise money. I'm going to tell you, when you seek the Lord with your whole heart, and you've done everything you know to do, the Bible says to stand and see the salvation of the Lord. And I'm telling you, he will come to you on your behalf. He will rescue you. He will do what needs to be done for you and unto you. I know it. I've seen it. I was there when she walked in the door. I was the one got the text. The money's in the mail. Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was the one that got the call. his way to the cross to die. He told us the great parable of Mark 11:23-24. If any of you shall say unto this mountain, the great parable of faith that gospel ministries have been built on around the world on this scripture. If you say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be cast into the sea, and doubt not, but believe what you said, you shall have what you say. Now, church, we got to say some stuff.
Yes.
This is not a zip-lit, mute gospel.
Yes.
This is a proclamation.
Yes.
He said, he told us more times than one to speak to the mountain. Yes. Say unto this, yes. I would say. We have to say some things,
yes.
And we have to make proclamations out of our mouth. And speak to the mountains in our lives. Now, it wasn't just a big, it's whatever your mountain is. If it's sickness, if it's an unsaved child, if it's marital problems, if it's your parents living with you with Alzheimer's, that is hard. I had it for 5 years. We know that. He's saying you speak to the mountain and he will come on the scene and help you. I can be a living proof to that. That with all the cancers that I told you about the other night, 10 years I spent most of my time in cancer centers taking care of young people with cancer. But you know what? God was faithful. And out of all of those, only the little 4-year-old I talked about last night, and God said I had another plan. I'm telling you, if you speak to the mountain and doubt not in your heart, but believe what you say, when you say it, you will see results from heaven. He said, you know, the world tells us that a man's last words are his most important. These were Jesus' last sayings as he was going to the cross. This is what I'm going to tell you, boys. I'm not going to be here long with you. This is what to do. Don't get caught up in money. Don't get caught up in titles. Don't get caught up in bribes. Don't get caught up in this, in pride. But he said, his feet and anoint him with that alabaster oil out of the box. And then she said, I'll dry your feet with my hair. See what she was doing? She was putting her glory over on him. Because 1 Corinthians 11:15 says a woman's glory is her hair. Jesus was teaching us here, put all your glory on Jesus. Put all your glory on the cross. Put all your glory on the crucified one. It's not for us to have any glory. I don't care if we want a million in India tomorrow. We better look up and say, thank you, Jesus, that you took that horrible walk, that you took that crucifixion, that these people in India may be saved. We better not try to take one ounce of glory and say, we got this and we got that. We don't have anything but the shed blood of Jesus Christ. We don't have what can wash away my sin. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. There ain't nothing can change the heart of a man but the blood of Jesus. We better not take any glory. He's teaching us that he puts this in there, that she dried her feet. Dried my feet with her hair. She was giving me all her glory. See, in Israel, they only do that for their bridegroom. She was saying, Jesus, I believe you're the bridegroom, and I want to bring you all my glory and place at your feet. Oh, church, that we place all the glory on our bridegroom who was bruised and beaten and smitten for this good salvation that we enjoy. Hallelujah. 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 Historians tell us that one reason they put this expensive oil on them is because when they're dying, they can still smell that on their body pasture, and it brings them comfort. They know somebody loved him enough to bring their expensive oil and put it on their body. And they say the aroma that comes up in their nostrils as they're dying brings comfort, as Jesus was hanging there suspended between heaven and earth, when he had on a crown of thorns, when he was given vinegar to drink, when he had pierced in his side, holes pierced in his side, but still yet, as he was hanging there, he could smell that and say, somebody love me. I am loved. He always exemplifies what he is. He is love. He is the epitome of love. And he's showing us, I'm going to show you how to die. You say not a word. You reach out to the thief beside you, even though he was caught in the very act and he's guilty. In your last breath, you reach out and you pull one more end to the cross. You pull one more end. He said, this day you will be with me in paradise. He wasn't saying, bless God, they've done all this to me. I'm going to hang up here and be bitter. He was reaching out for one more as he took his final breath. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, Savior, we have tonight. Hallelujah. 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 We worship you, Jesus, that you teach us how to act in hard times. You teach us how to act in unlawful times. See, these people in the temple, these money changers were unlawful. He's teaching us in this last day, when we become a lawless nation, don't get caught up in it. You might could get ahead a little bit. You might could do some wrongdoings and cheat some people and get ahead. He's saying, boys, that's not the way to go. I am, he said, I am turning this over. I am getting it out of the holy place. He's telling us, don't let that corruption come into the church where you can be bought to preach this and bought to preach that and bought not to preach this and bought not to preach that. We've got to keep principles as he did, with our face set like a flint to go to the cross. Luke 9, I think it is 15, said Jesus set his face steadfast toward Jerusalem. We've got to set our face steadfast toward the end times and the rapture of the church to go out of here and to ever be with him. Yeah. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior. Hallelujah. And then we look at the day that he rode into Jerusalem on the little donkey. Zechariah, 9:9. says, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king comes unto you. He is just. See, this was prophesied back in the Old Testament.
Yes.
Prophet knew Jesus was going to maintain his honor and integrity.
Right.
And he was going to go to the cross, just having salvation. Lowly, riding up on an ass and up on a colt, the foal of an ass. And see, Jesus, when he got into Jerusalem, he said, boys, go over here and get me a donkey to ride on, you know. And he said, if they ask you why, tell them the master has need of it.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you, I'm here to tell you tonight, the master has need of you.
Yeah.
When he was saying them to tell that the master had need of, once again, he was doing what his father would do, and he was saying, I have need of you. He was showing them the master has need. And see, the reason he came riding in on a donkey is that is a sign you're coming in peace. If you come on a white horse into Jerusalem or in those countries, it means you're coming in war. But when you came in riding on a donkey, it means I come in peace. Here came the Prince of Peace riding into Jerusalem, riding on a little donkey. And he had need of it as symbolically to let us know we have need of him. One time we were in Tennessee shopping, and my dad was a prophet. He heard from heaven, and I had my mom over in the dress section, and I had daddy said, I'm going to sit in the shoes while you all shop. Now, men, there's your thought. Just go sit in the shoes, and daddy would pray. He'd meditate. Now, don't get over there and just get all caught up in anything. But that's a good place to go and just close your eyes and say, Lord, I've had to bring my wife over here at the mall today, but I've come over here to meditate and be in your presence and hear from heaven. So I went over to check on daddy. I'd been over there with mom in the dress section, and this was in the 60s probably, but way before cell phones. I mean, we still back in the mountains had those party lines where eight people was on the same phone number. You know, everybody's phone rang and everybody knew everything everybody said. Everybody's phone rung. When it rang, you picked it up and you listened to everything that went on. Eight houses up and down the holler we lived in. So, I mean, we never heard of cell phones. So, but you know what? That's why we had to hear from heaven back in those mountains. We didn't have stuff, Pastor. We didn't have a lot of, we didn't have cable. We didn't have anything. So we had to hear from heaven. So Daddy said, Sid, go get your mama. He said, Holy Ghost just told me Brother Paul Collins worked. Now here we were in another state, 60 miles from home. He said, the Holy Ghost just told me Brother Paul Collinsworth is over here in the hospital in need of a touch. He said, it's critical. So I ran and got mom, and we loaded up the car, and we ran up to the unit, and they knew my dad. He visited the hospitals all the time. And so we went in, and that Mr. Paul was, and all the way there, Mr. Paul had a home for little boys that didn't have anywhere to go. And you know, back in the 60s, there was no welfare. There was no Social Security. There was no food stamps. There was no fuel assistance. There was nothing. If children didn't have anything, they just didn't have anything. And all the way there, he'd say, God, Brother Paul's got that home for those blessed little boys. They won't have anywhere to go. I'm asking you to touch Brother Paul today and lift him up. We walked in there, and Mr. Paul was flatlining. I mean, his EKG was flatlining. They didn't have all the modern technology they have now, and they were pumping him, trying to bring him back to life. And my dad did something so strange, and I didn't know it until I found this verse 40 years later. But he went over under the unction of the Holy Ghost, and he said, the same Jesus that rode the little donkey into Jerusalem has come by here today. Paul Collinsworth, be healed. That man sat up in the bed, and he said, Brother Sturgill, I was hoping somebody called you. There was no way to call except the Holy Ghost paged you. We had Holy Ghost pagers back 40, 50 years ago. We didn't have all this stuff. We had to be on our face and on our knees that the Holy Ghost could speak to us in our dress shop and say, get to the hospital quick. Mr. Paul's dying. Shout, oh daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king comes riding in. All lowly, on a donkey to spring salvation. He is a just man. He is the author and the finisher of our salvation. Shout unto the Lord. Shout unto the Lord. Lord, rejoice, oh daughter of Zion. Shout, oh daughter of Jerusalem.
You can hardly endure. Look.
taking you out. He said, I see a man of honor. I see a man that's going to feed children. I see a man that's going to take care of women. I see a man that's going to help the homeless. I'm going to reach down there. And though that heart stopped in the doctor's hand, he said, I'm going to breathe breath of life. I'm going to restore this man back to life. I'm telling you, there's a Jesus. Shout, shout. Oh, daughter of Jerusalem, behold your King, who has all power, who holds the world in the palm of his hand, who spoke things into order and created everything we see.
Daughter of
situation, above every funeral season of your life, he's still bigger and greater.